In the depths of the ocean, shrouded in mystery, perhaps the largest vertebrate predator ever meets up with one of the largest invertebrate predators. What happens when whale and squid collide in near darkness has been something humans have endlessly speculated on for centuries. As at least since people took interest in sperm whales and began hunting them, large circular scars have been noted on the whale's skin, which could be matched to mysterious carcasses of gigantic squid that very rarely washed ashore. With the knowledge that giant squid and sperm whales interact violently deep below the surface of the ocean, humans have tried to fill in the gaps, and because the meeting of two such large and powerful creatures captures the imagination, the scene of whale meeting squid has been depicted hundreds of times during nearly two centuries of literature, drawings, film, and video games. What I hope to do in this video is explore the history of how this battle beneath the sea has been depicted as our understanding of these two animals and their ecological interaction has evolved, as this is a very unique case study showing how knowledge changes over time, and with it how we depict nature in media. It seems the first people who learned of and speculated on an ecological interaction between the sperm whale, Physeter macrocephalus, and the giant squid, Archituthis dux, were the men who hunted sperm whales and gained insights by getting closer to these giants of the open ocean than most humans had ever before. They noticed ring scars on the heads of whales and found large beaks inside their stomachs. So it would make sense that one of the earliest popular depictions of what someone thought happened when sperm whales hunt giant squids appears during a chapter of Herman Melville's Moby Dick, the most famous book on sperm whale hunting and the bane of existence for generations of high school students. In one chapter, kind of early on, the whalers come across a giant squid on the surface at night, where the narrator describes what they think happens in the deep, with the squids using their many arms to hold onto the bottom, with the whales diving down to tear them off rock outcroppings. This, of course, is based on a lack of knowledge of Archituthis biology that we honestly are just starting to understand beyond the 19th century thoughts on them. Many depictions of giant squids in classic literature shows them associated with rocks and caves, as in perhaps the giant squid's most famous depiction, Jules Verne's 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, the submarine Nautilus is attacked by several individuals as it travels near some deep sea caves and disturbs them. This view of giant squid has some major errors. Squid in general are more pelagic and use their arms primarily for food acquisition and not benthic locomotion like an octopus. The giant squid in particular adapted to pelagic life. Though they do seem somewhat associated with the slopes of continents and islands, theirs is still mostly a world of drifting through the dark, no stationary objects with which to orient to. The view that they are denizens of the deepest oceans is also a misconception. The depth range is not completely understood, but it seems to be something like 300 to 1,000 meters, which correlates to what is known as the twilight zone of the ocean, where the light of the sun provides only the dimmest illumination. So dark that to be able to visually interpret anything, these squids need some of the largest eyes to ever exist. Moby Dick and 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea ultimately show two extremes of what people thought giant squids might behave like, with the animal being almost nothing more than a mass of jelly in the former, and in the words of the 1954 Disney adaptation, the latter depicts the most tenacious of sea beasts. What sperm whales do in the deep has also been highly debated. Sometimes the whale is a more active predator. While other hypotheses have the sperm whale as a more passive predator, drifting in the deep with the white coloration around the lower jaw acting as a lure, drawing in squid to the whale's maw. Today, most depictions of sperm whales show an active predator that dives down into the twilight zone and uses echolocation to find prey in the gloom. However, they often depict the meeting of squid and whale as an evenly matched fight, one that feels like the sperm whale is tackling a potentially dangerous prey that is difficult to subdue. These kinds of depictions are incredibly common, from images online, sculpture, and of course computer graphic recreations, such as those in BBC's Ocean Odyssey, a documentary on sperm whales from the same creators as Walking with Dinosaurs. Another really good example of this kind of depiction is from a cutscene in 2009's Endless Ocean Blue World, that depicts the squid's perspective as the whale comes out of the gloom like an oncoming train, but despite that is able to escape the jaws and hold onto the head of the whale before taking off into the darkness. Then afterwards you can watch the two entangled giants fight. The idea of such a battle captures the imagination, probably for similar reasons that scenes of dinosaurs battling are overrepresented in depictions of prehistoric life. This exciting possibility that somewhere right now a real-world kaiju battle between Kraken and Leviathan is occurring, somewhere in the depths of our ocean. Sometimes this kaiju battle shows the squid as the aggressor. The most prominent recent example I can think of appears in Assassin's Creed Black Flag in a short cutscene Easter egg where you can spy the battle out of the window of a shipwreck, where a squid swims up to a whale and drags the larger animal into the depths. This is an incredibly erroneous depiction, as it is the opposite of how the interaction goes down. The whale goes into the squid's habitat to hunt, not the other way around, and ultimately giant squids are simply no match for a sperm whale. In giant squids, the female is larger, measuring from the tip of the mantle to the ends of the eight arms, around 5 meters long, with two long thin tentacles stretching perhaps an additional 6 to 7 meters beyond that. Though this is from dead specimens where the soft, boneless body may have become stretched beyond what is represented in life. All in an animal about 275 kilograms, which is absolutely massive for an invertebrate. However, the average sperm whale cow, which are generally quite a bit smaller than bulls, is 11 meters long and 14,000 kilograms, with an average bull sperm whale being 16 meters and 41,000 kilograms. This is not a fight. It is a bust-sized predator appearing out of the dark with the intent to suck the squid down the throat in seconds. All the squid can do is try to dodge the whale or desperately try to cling to the head as the whale eats the poor creature. While the odds are overwhelmingly stacked in the whale's favor, sometimes depictions of fight scenes push that even further, like Discovery Channel's Animal Face-Off, which gives the whale the additional ability of sonic blast, creating a sound so loud the pressure wave can stun prey, rendering the squid unconscious. The acoustic prey debilitation hypothesis was a neat idea, formed from observations of squid taken from sperm whale stomachs lacking any tooth marks, or otherwise healthy-looking whales with severely deformed lower jaws, so it was proposed that they might emit a sound so loud it could be used to stun prey, which could then be eaten at the whale's leisure. So like any good hypothesis, this can be tested. So some scientists strapped audio recorders on some sperm whales to hear what sounds they make, and well, they never recorded anything like a crazy sonic knockout. That said, they only recorded 66 or so hours of audio, which is a fair amount, but like I have worked with far longer recordings for behavioral research projects I have analyzed in the past, so maybe they missed a whale delivering a debilitating sound. This same study seems to be our best look at how sperm whales might hunt large cephalopods in the depths. And I think the 2020 game Beyond Blue's depiction of giant squid versus sperm whale is currently the most up-to-date representation, which is no surprise as the creators collaborated with ocean experts to create a game that reflects our current understanding of marine ecosystems. This short cutscene, as well as a video you can find here on YouTube on the official channel of New Zealand's Te Papa Museum, titled Search and Destroy, I think are both based on the previously mentioned study, which until someone manages to get a sperm whale hunting a giant squid on video, like what is depicted in Beyond Blue, is the best direct evidence for what is going down in the Twilight Zone. We do have footage of sperm whales hunting, just not a giant squid. In both animations, the whale is echolocating, sending out clicks, and listening to the echo, until the whale registers something large ahead. Suddenly, the echolocation speeds up into a continuous stream, locking onto the target. Then, the whale slams into the squid, and all the squid can do is desperately grab at the whale's head, while being sucked down the throat. Now, as I mentioned, we apparently do have footage from cameras stuck to the backs of sperm whales, just not a giant squid hunt. Probably because finding a single large squid somewhere out in the deep is less efficient than eating a bunch of smaller squid. A study off the Galapagos found whales mostly fed on squid under 1 kilogram. Though, to be fair, a study off of Antarctica found that 77% of the biomass consumed by sperm whales was colossal squid, which are even more massive than giant squid. So maybe we should put cameras on whales off the Ross's ice shelf to get footage of sperm whales hunting a large cephalopod? Just a thought. Unfortunately for giant squids, the sperm whale may not be the only whale with a taste for their flesh. However, this one might actually be a bit more exciting to speculate on. The short-finned pilot whale is a large dolphin species that, like the sperm whale, hunts at depth. At 4 to 7 meters in length and anywhere from 1,000 to 4,000 kilograms, they are much smaller than sperm whales, and though that gives them a big weight advantage over a giant squid, the smaller size probably means bringing one down is a bit more of a struggle, and they also hunt differently. Sperm whales dive down into the twilight zone for hunts lasting nearly an hour, swimming along rather slowly. Pilot whales sprint hunt. They rapidly descend, echolocate around to find potential prey, and, at the deepest part of the dive, speed up to catch the prey and then come back to the surface all within about 20 minutes. This strategy of hunting has been compared to how cheetahs hunt, as a high-risk, high-reward kind of hunting, with the capture of a large, high-caloric prey item being worth the potential of not finding anything in the short time. Like with the sperm whales, this was discovered by deploying acoustic devices, which also contained accelerometers. Generally, they seem to be hunting medium-sized squid, but there are some tantalizing clues that they do take bigger prey. Freshly severed pieces of giant squid have been found floating around the whales, making it quite probable these whales are going for giant squid when they detect one. This sounds like a pretty intense hunt, a whale perhaps shorter than a giant squid but a bit heavier, racing out of the dark to grab onto the large prey item. What does the squid do? The pilot whale's mouth is so much smaller than that of the sperm whale, can they swallow a giant squid whole? Is the squid actually able to fight back or escape from these smaller dolphins? Interesting things to speculate on. Thank you for watching this episode of Ecotasia. This is a natural history channel, and I wanted to play with expanding that idea a little bit and try my hand at investigating our connection to nature through popular culture and art as a longtime consumer of such media. However, I spend most of my time out getting footage of wild animals, and so if you were intrigued by giant squids fighting sperm whales, perhaps you want to watch another animal battle, this one between the infamous bullet ant and their arch nemesis, the zombie fly. I think you'll really like it.